We're talking at the moment about terror acts after another dreadful act in Reading yesterday evening. Boris Johnson says the government is ready to act on any lessons that can be learned. What lessons can be learned? 0345 6060 973. And joining me now is Dr. Alan Mendoza, who's founder and executive director of the Henry Jackson Society. Alan, good evening to you.
Good evening, Clive.
What do you feel then? Can lessons be learned from these continuing terror attacks in the UK?
Well, yes, of course lessons can be learned, but the real problem is that the same lessons being learned over and over again, or not learned, we speak of learning them, then don't learn them.
Not
acted upon, exactly. I mean, we've been with terrorism now in this country of this kind, radicalisation of this kind, for, 15, 20 years, and we're not actually picking up on those lessons and taking them forwards. And there are numerous examples of people who've put forward suggestions, but we're still in this whole point, and slowly we tackle it piecemeal. We need to have a much more holistic way of looking at the problem and dealing with it, because otherwise we're going to see this repeated again and again.
As we are doing at the moment. Can you give me some examples of, I know you're saying holistic, but what kind of things do we need to be considering then?
Well, I think you've got to look at this from two or three different ways. The first point is that when you speak about, for example, the intelligence services, you're dealing with the end of the conveyor belt, if you like. What you have there is someone who's been radicalised already, who's on the verge of committing a terrorist attack of some kind. And that's when normally the intelligence services get wind of what's going on and hopefully can prevent it. So obviously there is a role for prevention at the last minute type thing, when plots are being formed. But you have to go, I think, a little earlier in the process to see what's happened. We mentioned in prisons, for example, what's happening in prisons. The answer, by the way, your previous guest suggesting that people shouldn't be in prison, that's not the answer. The answer is make prisons safe places for criminals so they get radicalised in that sense. I mean, that's obviously the answer, not don't put them in prison. Why is it that our prisons have such a bad incidence of radicalisation compared to many other prisons around the world? There's clearly best practice that can be followed in other places to stop that. So you can look a step earlier.
Well, isn't it because prisons are understaffed and can barely manage to just keep normal law and order within a prison, let alone stop radicalisation?
Well, that is one reason. I would agree with you, yes. I think clearly you're looking at more resources being put into this area and a recognition that if you don't put more resources into this particular focus, you will end up with more serious criminals coming out the other end, which is, of course, not what you want from the prison experience at all. It's supposed to be a corrective process, not a reinforcing criminality process. So, yes, you're right there. But then you go right back to the first step, which is essentially, what is it that's driving people to sort of get into this whole extremist mindset? What is it in society? And obviously, if you look at the pattern of terrorism of this kind in the last decade, you're seeing a variety of different cases, but there is a theme that emerges, which is a sense of not quite belonging, a sense of not being part of society in some way, shape or form. And we've had in the past examples of reviews that have been done to look at this particular problem. I'm thinking particularly of the Casey review, Dame Louise Casey's review that came out in December 2016, that looked precisely at the problem of communities that were not integrating or were not assimilating properly, and set out ways that could be addressed, ways of teaching British values, ways of integration, all sorts of things that could be put in, bringing women who were marginalised into the community, getting young people of various backgrounds to mix. And yet we've had, different governments not taking those recommendations forward. Do you want to go back to first, principles here and drain the swamp of extremism before it even starts? You've got to start with community integration. You start there and then you can always look at the other bits along the way as well.
And would you go even further back and look at the UK's foreign policy as well? Certainly some people have been phoning LBC today saying that in a sense the country has brought this upon ourselves because of our military interventions, getting involved in global politics.
Look, this is such a foolish argument, because if you look at what the nature of radicalisation we're talking about here, which is radical Islam, it's got nothing to do with British foreign policy. It's a creed and ideology that is self-sustaining and based on its own principles that highlights anything we do, whether it is good or bad abroad, whether it is good or bad at home, in order to target people here. Its enemy is not UK foreign policy. Its enemy is the UK's liberal democratic values, not just ours, of course, but the liberal democratic values of all right-thinking people around the world. That's what its enemy is. It doesn't care whether you go back or forth. It will attack you regardless, which is why you'll recall countries like Finland have had terrorist attacks, radical Muslim terrorist attacks. What's Finland ever done in the world to justify that? It's a real false argument to suggest foreign policy has caused this when it's really down to an evil ideology.
Thank you very much indeed. Good to talk to you, Dr. Alan Mendoza, founder and executive director of the Henry Jackson Society.